about a struggle that has started in an area called Qala Reserve. In Qala, in an area in the former Qalanga Magisterial District, which is now under the Sakisizwe local municipality in the Eastern Cape. And this should be understood in the context of what Professor Nzebeza was saying about how rural people under traditional leaders have experienced democracy or lack of up since 1994 up to the current moment. The experience of the residents of Qala Reserve who had to struggle against the government to have an elected headman shows the challenges of rural residents in democratic South Africa. To the residents, democracy means very little because the government, in court with traditional leaders, treats them as non-citizens by denying them the right to elect their leaders. And their villagers had to go to the High Court for the government and traditional leaders to respect their rights. This was after the Kwaitina Traditional Council imposed an unelected headman in the village in March 2013. Okay. In the institution of traditional leaders, you have a king who is the highest in the hierarchy. You have a chief under the king, and in most cases you would have a number of chiefs under the king, accounting to the king. And below the chief or chiefs, you have headmen who are, or a chief would be in control of a number of villages that are controlled by headmen. So a headman is a local head in the context of where the chief is. Yeah. So the villagers had to go to the High Court for the government and traditional leaders to respect their rights. This was after the Kwaitina Traditional Council imposed an unelected headman in the village in March 2013. The imposition of an unelected headman happened against an established tradition since the colonial era in the former Qalanga Magisterial District, that of election of headmen by the residents. And the words of one of the representatives of the Kwaitina Traditional Council, who arrogantly stated that whether you like it or not, it is the royal family that decides on the headman, captures the attitude of traditional leaders in the current period. The case of Qala Reserve is one in a number of unreported cases of imposed headmen in Qalanga. All four traditional councils of Qalanga have some imposed headmen. The imposition of headmen started in after the promulgation of the Provinces Act, the Traditional Leadership and Governance Framework, Governance Act of 2005, and the process of imposing headmen started in Tsengiwe in 2007. Tsengiwe is under the Eswatini Traditional Council. Although the residents took up the case, that is the residents of Tsengiwe, it never went further, and the imposed headman led until his death in 2017. The example of Tsengwe must have given traditional leaders confidence in that a number of headmen were imposed in other villages such as Mbodlane in 2008, Apacala in 2009, Indwana in 2014, and these are under different traditional councils, as I mentioned them there. Moreover, besides Tsengwe and Tsala Reserve, there have been no opposition against undemocratic actions of traditional leaders in the area. Tsala Reserve presented the most sustained and focused resistance to the actions of traditional leaders. Now, what happened in the case of Tsala Reserve? In March 2013, the Kwaitsina Traditional Council imposed this unelected headman on the residents after the retirement of an incumbent who was elected in 1979. The KTC imposed the headman despite the residents having supplied the particulars of the candidate they had elected a month earlier, that is in February 2013. A letter to the local committee, or a letter the local committee in Tsala Reserve wrote to the traditional council was ignored, even though the chairperson of the traditional council had invited the residents to express their complaints in writing. The letter marked the beginning of the struggle in Tsala Reserve. Various levels of traditional leaders were unsuccessfully approached for intervention. Instead, the traditional leaders claimed that the new legislation, that is the Traditional Leadership and Governance Framework Act of 2003, took the residents' right of electing their headmen away. It's a point that Professor Nsebeza also made yesterday, that this was based on how traditional leaders interpret the act. Even the provincial MEC for the Department of Cooperative Governance and Traditional Affairs and the Premier's office, who are elected leaders, took the side of traditional leaders when approached about the matter. They argued that the act prescribed that headmen be appointed by royal families. And faced with such a situation, the residents resorted to the High Court in 2014, which ruled that the imposition of an unelected headman amounted to undermining the community's rights, custom of electing their headmen, and the appointment was set aside. The judge's decision in the lower division of the High Court was based on Professor Nsebeza's research, which shows that all headmen in Kalanga, except in Mbenga, have historically been elected. It was a case, it was the same research that helped the local committee in Tsala Reserve to identify an angle in its opposition to the imposed headmen. The Premier's office, the MEC for COCTA, and the Provincial House of Traditional Leaders, as well as the KTC, that is the Traditional Council, Kwaitsina Traditional Council, appealed the judgment, basically arguing that the judge had in saying the tradition of rural residents be respected and in electing their leaders. A full bench of judges heard the appeal in August 2015 and confirmed the judgment of the lower division court, meaning that the judgment is not only applicable in Kalanga but all over the Eastern Cape. As will be seen later, the judgment became a tool the local non-governmental organization, that is Tsalusa, working with the affected communities, the Border Rural Committee, which is another NGO in the Eastern Cape, and Ndinga Ndabagandota used to mobilize various rural areas. Since the struggle in 2013, it has forced the local committee in Ngqala Reserve to be organized. It meets now weekly to discuss and strategize around issues that affect them. Although it still relies a lot on the legal system, but you can see that they are trying to take up issues on their own, that is the rural residents, under led by a local committee there. And the committee has been organizing, besides the regular weekly meetings, they also organize annual public meetings to brief the community, especially the migrant workers from Ngqala Reserve, about developments in the area. And this has helped in mobilization of support from migrant workers, but it also builds rural urban linkages among the residents. Presentations in the community radio, which is Vugani Community Radio, have popularized the campaign throughout the Krisani District Municipality, because the community radio covers the whole district. Consequently, more communities are coming forward with their issues of governance. A number of rural communities within the Krisani District Municipality, e.g. Whittlesea, Bengu, Onga, Makai Snake, and Ntlalonhle in the Lady Frey area, Kuba, Lahlangubo in the Indwe area, and Bayele and Kumango in the Ngobo area, have also sought assistance in their problems regarding rural governance. There have also been communities with similar problems outside the Krisani District Municipality in areas such as Amahlathi in the towards the East London area, Stadarem, Ngehana in Tandane, Prudo in the Pedi area. In 2014, Siyazakha Land and Development Forum, a local forum of rural people, and Talusa established a task team called Democratization Task Team, consisting of representatives from various villages that have issues of governance. And basically the idea has been to have this structure coordinating the various struggles in the area, in the Kalanga area. But it has moved beyond the Kalanga area through various means, including workshops that have been organized and involving representatives from the various areas that have issues of governance. The community radio has also been used to report on the Ngqala Reserve judgment and the other cases of rural governance across the province. Due to the local pressure and impact of the judgment, Chief Stokwe of Makwatini Traditional Council, which is one of the four traditional councils in the area, had to withdraw an imposed headman that was imposed in 2014. And this was due to, as I say, to the pressure from the court, but also the pressure from communities. And an elected headman has since been installed in the village. Besides Indwana, four other communities under different traditional councils have held elections in 2017 of headmen. And this is all due to the pressure that the case has had on the traditional leaders, but also the demand that has grown because communities have developed confidence when they saw that the community of Ngqala Reserve was able to successfully challenged the imposed headmen, and this has made other communities to develop confidence. Just to show how the traditional councils are in the Kalanga area, as I said, there are four traditional councils. One of them is Ehlathini Traditional Council. The other one is Kolombeni Traditional Council, Makwatini Traditional Council, and the last one is Kwaitsena Traditional Council. Kwaitsena Traditional Council is the one that Tsala Reserve belongs to. Of the four traditional councils, it is Makwatini and Kwaitsena Traditional Councils that are led by chiefs. The other two are led by headmen. Each traditional council consists of a number of villages that are led by headmen who are accountable to the chief and the royal family. The Kwaitsena Traditional Council, which consists of six administrative areas that are led by six headmen, illustrates the point that I'm making above, that each traditional council has a number of villages under it who are led by headmen. You have six villages in the Kwaitsena Traditional Councils, and the names are there. It is also these headmen and members of the royal family that constitute 60% of the unelected members in a traditional council. In terms of legislation, the membership of traditional councils is supposed to be 60% are people who are unelected, and 40% are elected, and 1/3 of the members of the traditional councils should be women. So the 60% in the context of the Kwaitsena Traditional Council consists of the six headmen and members of the royal family.
Just a question. Those proportions, who decided on those proportions, the 60% and 40%?
Well, it's the Act that prescribes that.
So the Act includes 60% unelected members, so it still plays around a bit with unelected representation.
Yeah. As I move towards the end, I'm looking at possibilities and implications of this democratization struggle. And one of the things that I am raising is that a chief derives power from headmen who account to him. And the full bench judgment did not only confirm the lower division judgment, but also declared that the tradition of communities that elect their headmen be respected. And in the context of Kalanga, where you have 21 headmen, what this means is that all the 21 headmen except one, that is unelected, in terms of the tradition of the area, would have to be elected. So it means that the judgment says that all the headmen in the area must be elected. And if the majority of these headmen are elected and are accountable to their communities, the two chiefs will lose their power over the residents. They become isolated and may be forced by circumstances to be more answerable to the residents than upwards. The campaign has developed its own momentum and is spreading across the Chris Hani District municipality and parts of the Eastern Cape. And in November, for instance, in November 2017, representatives of more than 22 rural villages went to King Matanzima in Kamata to demand democracy and respect of their rights. And these are communities that are outside the Kalanga area where the struggle has started. And this shows that there is, the mood to challenge the imposition of unelected leaders is growing and is spreading beyond the Kalanga area where this started. Following the Kala Reserve judgment, rural people in the Stadarem area have also successfully used the High Court in 2017 to reject a chief that imposed himself, and the representatives of rural people clearly expressed the demand for democratization of governance in a provincial conference that was organized by traditional leaders and the South African Local Government Association in 2016.
Just a question here on a very local basis. What authorities and powers do these headmen have? Can they do our driver's licenses, electricity, or what do they do? What is their power?
Headmen in a local village assist communities or residents residents whenever they want services. For instance, they want to be served by the Department of Social Development. They would go to the headman for an endorsement, get a letter that confirms that this is a resident of this area. For social development to provide a service to the community. They also deal with cases of civil cases in the locality where there are clashes between families. Those are some of the things in the process of circumcision of boys. They are also involved in endorsing, in confirming that these are residents in this area, and they work closely with the Department of Health. So they serve they play various roles. And in some cases, they also participate in local government. In municipalities, some of them would represent their traditional council in the council, municipal council. Well, they are also responsible for land allocation. In a local level. Okay.
In terms of the election, is when a headman is elected, is it on a periodic basis, or is it once for?
Well, in terms of the act, it does not prescribe. The assumption is that the headman would be there until he decides to resign or he dies. The only group that has time frames in terms of their tenure in the traditional council is the 40% representatives. The 60% can be there until they decide to leave or die in their positions. Yes, yes, yes. Ma'am?
How do you get paid by the
Headmen are under the Department of Cooperative Governance and Traditional Affairs, so they get their salaries. I think they vary. I know the one that is was involved in this case, the headman in Tsala Reserve, the imposed one, was getting about 9,000 a month. But I understand that in some areas they can get more. And I think this has to do with the size of the area under their jurisdiction. Oh. Okay. Can I finish? Then you raise your questions. No, I'm not jumping. There are serious implications that the serious political implications that arise out of this case and the campaign that emanates from the Tsala Reserve case. One of those is that it has awakened rural people, and they are no. I mean, in some of the areas, they have started to question traditional leaders, their actions, and this means that they are no longer easily manipulated, some of those communities, by traditional leaders. But the other implication of this is that it means that now the power base of political parties becomes threatened, because now, as Professor Ntsebeza was saying, that there is an assumption that if political parties have a hold on traditional leaders, the support base is going to be guaranteed for those political parties. But now this situation is throwing this up and is showing that this is no longer going to be as easy as it would have been before this case. The other thing is that until now we have seen the character of protests around services being more urban based. There are now questions being raised by communities about services, both from the government but also from the traditional leaders, because the question they are rural residents, some residents are raising, is you are getting paid and we want services from you. So we are likely going to see an emergence of protests around services in from rural areas also. The other point that I've made is the linkages that have developed among rural communities, and this has been seen when the Amadiba Crisis Committee leader Bazuka was killed in 2016. There was solidarity from various communities in the Eastern Cape who went and attended even the funeral. When the Coffee Bay communities, fishing communities in Coffee Bay, where their rights, fishing rights, were threatened, there was also solidarity that came from the communities around the Eastern Cape. So this, to me, raises the possibilities of reemergence of rural struggles and resistance in the province. The last point that I make is that this is also going to impact on the electoral system of the country, because if communities elect their leaders and are satisfied about the role their leaders play. The question would be, what councillors play? Because what councillors are elected but decided by political parties. Now, if communities are electing their leaders at a local level, there's going to be a question about the role of ward councillors. And to me, this is going to lead to questions about the electoral system in the country. Thank you. Okay.
Two questions, if I may. First of all, the questioning of the role of headman and the election of headman, has that spread from the Eastern Cape, or has interest in it spread from the Eastern Cape to, let's say, KwaZulu-Natal, the Free State, Mpumalanga? I mean, has interest been shown by other areas of the country where this similar form of local government exists? That's the one question. And the second just intrigued me. How does a chief try to impose himself?
On the first question, I happen to be involved through Talusa in an effort to build a movement of rural people at a national level, and this is led by an NGO that is based here called the Trust for Community Outreach and Education. That NGO has facilitated the establishment of a rural movement called Inyanda, which has affiliates in various parts of the country. And through that organization, that national organization, we have learned that, of course, this case in Tsala Reserve and the struggles that have developed in the province are discussed in at that national platform. And this has led to some areas in Limpopo, for instance, to say that there are concerns that are being raised by residents in certain parts of Limpopo. I also know that when we were in Ficksburg in 2016, there were representatives from Mpumalanga who were also saying that they are taking up struggles, and these struggles are revolving around the role of chiefs in the mining sector, how chiefs are taking decisions about land and investments on the land by mining companies in the without consulting communities. So there is an interest, but I would say this is still initial stages, but there is some interest that is being shown. KwaZulu-Natal, we have not had people from KwaZulu-Natal that we work with. The second question about the chief imposing himself is that this is a community that claimed and made a claim, and they proved it in the High Court that historically they never had a chief. And this chief came after 2007, after the promulgation of the act. So that's why I'm saying he imposed himself on the community, because the community say that they never had a chief, and they don't want a chief now. There was a hand there. I would take some of the examples where they have been elected headmen. In the case of Tsengiwe, which falls under a Eswatini Traditional Council, the headman in Tsengiwe constitutes the 60%, but now he is elected. He's part of the 60%, but is an elected now the leader, and there's another village in the area, I mean under the same jurisdiction, that also had an elected headman. Those are part of the 60% that was unelected, but now they have been elected. So I think this is going to gradually change the composition of traditional leaders. I mean traditional councils, sorry.
But does that not mean that the composition, that legislation has to change in the light of the court pronouncement?
Yeah. Well, that was the intention. That was our intention to challenge this the imposition. We said that we are not going to outrightly say that we are challenging the legislation, but we want to use this case as a leverage so that it influences changes in legislation. So I suppose this is what's going to happen, but it's going to take some time, because there's a lot of resistance from traditional leaders.
I have some other questions. Are there any head women? And then you mentioned one chief. But does this development, will that not impact on chiefs having to be elected? You mentioned one such instance. And my third question is, are there headmen in the urban areas? You speak about the migrant workers being employed. But given the residents of migrants in urban areas, are they head men or head women also in the urban areas?
I missed the first question. The second one is about head women, and the third one is head men in urban areas.
Yeah, since it's now the movement to elect head men, will it impact on the election that we would have chiefs elected? And more so because of yesterday's lecture in which Professor Ntsebeza mentioned chiefs have been imposed.
In the area we are working, we are working in the Crescent District Municipality, There have been no head women. I suppose the this is because up to the development of the of this campaign, traditional leaders have been taking decisions on their own, and I want to believe that as communities develop confidence and on the election of their leaders, women will also emerge as possible candidates.
So linked to this, I mean, you said a third of the traditional council, according to the law,
yes,
is supposed to be women.
Women, yes.
Is this the case?
Well, in some areas, there is a claim that the women constitute the one third, but I must say that we have not really looked at this closely. It's one of the areas that I think we need to look at as we move forward with this campaign. The issue of headmen in urban areas, I don't know now what the situation is going to be, because with the new legislation, the traditional and Khoisan leadership bill, which is moving towards being an act, some of the leaders are based in urban areas, so I don't know whether this would mean that there would also be headmen in urban areas. But the current situation is that headmen are in rural areas because they lead villages, as I indicated. I would express this more as my wish as this campaign develops, because if communities develop confidence and elect their leaders at the local level, headmen and the headmen, then the chief becomes an isolated person who is, I mean, my thinking is that eventually there is going to be a demand from below to have even chiefs their position getting endorsed by residents rather than being decided outside the will of the residents. Okay.
I'm involved in a business where we can share people, that's indigent people, and illiterate people. How to make a living?
They don't hear you.
I'm involved in a business where we share people, indigent and illiterate people, how to make a decent living. I mean, how to make some 13,000 rand a month out of a small plot of land, 1,000 square meters. Business. We don't own the land, we're just specialists in this work. And I'm asking you, but we do have to do it in villages where there's something like 300 people, 300 families, that's the minimum we can. It works that way, it doesn't work with fewer people. I'm just asking, where would one start to try and start villages like that in the traditional areas? Because it sounds to me as if it's ripe for that kind of those kind of skills.
Do you want to try and respond to the question? I would have to think about it.
Let's hope you cannot hear me. I don't need the mic. I think there are two issues that arise now from the court decision. The lower court used my affidavit, and my affidavit was based on on my interpretation of the traditional leadership and governance framework act. And that act is very clear. It says that the authority to appoint a headman rests with the royal family, comma, subject to the customary law of that particular area.
Subject
to the customary law of that area. So all I had to do when I was writing my affidavit was say that, look, let's agree on this interpretation. And when once we agree with that interpretation, one would have to look at what the customary law of that particular area was. And in this area, the practice was very clear that over 100 years, over a century, the people were happy electing their head. Even our date couldn't change. Because now, even our democratic government will change that. So that's one element. If that subject to the customary law hadn't been there in the act, then I think there would have been a problem. My argument would not have helped so whatsoever. But the higher court, not the higher court, the full bench went beyond accepting the argument we were making. It looked at the Constitution and said that in terms of the Constitution, traditional leaders, the institution and its incumbent, are recognized subject to the Constitution, especially the Bill of Rights. And then the judge, who read the judgment, went on to identify sections in the Constitution that dealt with the need to democratize this country. This is why he ended up saying that if anything could be made about the Federal Reserve case, it should serve as an example of how the institution of traditional leadership and chiefs generally could be democratized. So, but we didn't make that argument. I couldn't make that argument because in my earlier work, as I said yesterday, I had said that the Constitution is confusing us. It needs to be changed. But the judge actually said the Constitution is pointing the way forward. You don't have to change it.
Okay.
What exactly was the force that led to disenchantment with the previous system? What were they not doing that caused the change that you sought? I mean, I know it's a good thing to do, but why were they not delivering? were supposed to be delivering, your imposed chiefs and your imposed head, what were they doing wrong?
Well, the issue of rural residents is not about their ability to deliver or not, but it's more about the power of residents to decide who should lead in their areas. Of course, there had been in a number of cases. In fact, the meeting that I referred to in November 2017, where communities went to Kamata to express their displeasure at how traditional leaders were handling them. In the submissions there were clear cases where traditional leaders were abusive to residents. In some cases, I mean, people were beaten up. In some cases, they were denied rights, various rights. Yeah. I think there was a hand somewhere here. Oh, I'll give you.
It's sort of a follow on to what you were asking, which is about the conditions that were in place or the characteristics of that community that meant that it was the first community to take it as far as a legal challenge. What was unique or special in Tsala that allowed for that?
Okay. I think Tsala Reserve is an area where the NGO has been working since its establishment, because it's closer to Tsala, I mean to town, where the offices of the NGO are. There have been a number of programs the organization has been running in the communities surrounding Tsala, and Tsala Reserve has been a beneficiary of that. As a result of that, there has been an emergence of local leaders there who in the early 90s, when local government was transformed after 1994, they participated in local government processes, planning processes, and this was through after they have been through workshops that were run by the NGO. So there has been capacity building that has led to development of these local leaders, Tsala Reserve being one of those areas. Yeah. Okay.
Normally in the municipality, you've got the mayor and the ward councillors.
Hmm.
Now, how do the chiefs and headmen and the traditional councils fit in with the municipal structures?
Well, in the constitution, there is a concept they use, cooperative governance, which says that, and also in the legislation, the Traditional Leadership and Governance Framework Act, it talks about the need for traditional leaders to be incorporated in municipal processes. The representatives of traditional leaders get nominated by their institution to represent them in the council as ex officio members in the council. And in most cases, it at a local level, at a local municipal level, you'd find that it's mostly headmen that are representing traditional councils in the municipality. But you also have ward councillors that come from political parties, not from traditional. The institution of traditional leaders. So they are there not as councillors. They cannot play that role. They would be there just to participate in discussions, and in terms of legislation, they are also expected to make inputs about what needs to be done at a municipal level. At a district level, the higher you go, at the district level, you would have some chiefs sent to the district municipalities to represent the institution, and this goes up to the province. But they are not politicians when they are there. They are there as traditional leaders to take care of the needs of their subjects. That's what is expected of them. There's a hand there. Well, there's been no open reaction from political parties, but you can sense at a local level that some political parties are not happy about the developments that are taking place. For instance, in the Kalanga area, where the Mandashe happens to be from, he has, of course, himself and the MEC for safety in the province have tried to marginalize these leaders that are emerging. And in every occasion that they get an opportunity to decide who should represent the communities, they would marginalize them outrightly, and instead would side with the unelected leaders.
That appeals against the lower court. Yes, because we said it can go away.
In fact, it was the premier, the MEC. They appealed that judgment. Yeah. Okay.
The judgment by the bench of judges now, does their judgment apply only to the Eastern Cape, or would it be taken to apply nationally if there were developments elsewhere?
I'm not a legal person, so I'm not sure how can the judgment be made applicable nationally. But I suppose, and we were hoping in the case that after the appeal by the province, we were hoping that they would want to go to Bloemfontein. so that this has a national impact. Besides that, I'm not sure how this can be made to have a national influence. Maybe the last 10. Okay.
Are there any mayors who are headmen or chiefs?
Can you repeat?
Are there any mayors? Mayor?
Mayors? Mayors.
Yeah. Who
are headmen or chiefs?
Yeah.
No. No. I don't know of any mayor that is comes from a royal family. Mm.
It is a 16th, so it's a kind of lecture. But Fani is here, I'm here, so we can continue talking. And I just wanted to make one announcement. On Thursday, there have been various people who have approached us and have suggested that on Friday, not Thursday, the fourth lecture, that the fourth lecture should focus on the issue of expropriation without compensation. And I'm happy the issue of expropriation without compensation, which is very current. Okay. And so on. And I'm happy also to read.
That would be Friday the 5th.
That's Friday, yes. And tomorrow, we looked at the politics of the current side. And tomorrow we'll look at the economy, economic issues, land, and so on. And we deliberately planned this year's week to focus on the former participants, because those are for the